gospel service Bible study, Wednesday night Bible study. It is good to be in the house of the Lord.
Oh, yeah, go ahead. You don't
one
do that.
More time. Amen. And you give God a hand clap. For the many blessings He bestowed upon us today. Amen. We'll start off with a word of prayer. Father God, we come before you. We thank you. We love you. We honor you. We adore you for who you are, because you're God Almighty, God alone. We thank you for blessing us to have a place to come and worship, a place to come and study. We thank you that you've given us the strength, our health and strength, so that we can come together, as your word says in Hebrews 25:10, to forsake not to assemble, so we're assembling to study your word. We ask that you dwell among us. Hallelujah, we need you in our presence. We ask, Father God, that our words, our mouth, that we speak will be acceptable in your sight, because you are our strength and our redeemer. These blessings and more we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So my name is Deborah Levine. Some say Minister Levine. Deb is good for me. Praise the Lord that I'm able to come before you. I'm excited about, we're at the end of the first chapter of John, and I want to just review a little bit about the book of John, and then the first chapter we'll review, and then we'll pick up at the end of chapter one. So the book of John, it's not certain when the book was written. It's believed to be written in the first century, and it's also one of the books that's considered the deepest book of the Bible. So John wrote the Bible, and he did not speak of himself. And so when we speak of the book of John, or the person of John in this gospel, we are referring to who?
John the Baptist.
To John the Baptist. Amen. Amen. And I want to, give me just a second. We spoke in chapter 1, the deity of Christ. Chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. And what does that mean? The deity of Christ.
That Jesus is God.
That Jesus is God. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. And we also talked about the pre-incarnation of Christ. Pre-incarnation of Christ.
And the Messiah.
What else does it mean?
I was getting my paper straight.
I'm sorry. Anyone else? Someone. So if you look in verse 3 through 5 of John 1, and it speaks to the pre-incarnation of Christ.
Said all things was made through him. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So he was there from the beginning, regardless. Nothing was made without him, or anything that was made. So there you go.
You take your mask off?
No. No.
So
but that's what it is.
God. So it was. He explained it very well. The pre-incarnation of Christ is that in the beginning. Nothing was made, and anything that was made was through Christ. Amen. Amen. So we also discuss the beginning and what the meant. What does the word THE mean?
Time.
So it
time
means
started.
That's when time started. Very good. That's when time started. We discussed the forerunner. Who was the forerunner of Christ?
John the Baptist.
John the Baptist. So what did they think? Who did they think John was?
I thought he was Elijah. I thought he was the Christ. thought he was the Messiah.
Very good. That he was Elijah, they thought he was the Christ, and they thought he was the Messiah. So who is they that we're referring to?
The people.
People of Judah, Israel, the Jews.
The Jews, very good, very good. And then speaking of the Jews, who rejected Christ?
The Jews.
Good segue, right? The Jews rejected Christ. Amen. So we talked about that in verse 9 through 11, the rejection of Christ. And then the acceptance of Christ in 12 and 13, chapter 1. Can someone elaborate on that?
On what?
On chapter 1, 12 and 13, the acceptance of Christ.
So are you talking about the people, or are you just talking about those who believe?
Those who believe. The people.
The ones who would believe would become children of God if they so believe.
So if you so believe, you'll become a child of God. Amen. Anyone else want to add to that?
You said 12 and 13?
Yes, ma'am.
There's no other way.
There's no other way?
No other way.
One way?
One way.
One way. Amen. Amen. The incarnation of Christ, 14 through 18, we discussed that. Can someone elaborate on those verses? Quick summary.
The word became human.
14 through 18 in chapter 1.
Living in our life. He took on flesh. The word became human. You want me to read that?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
That would work.
14 through 1.
Through 18.
Okay. I'll read. The word became a human and living among us. He saw his glory. The glory that belonged to the only Son of God, and he was full of grace and truth. John tells the truth about him and cries out saying, "This is the one I told you about. The one who came after me is greater than I am because he was living before me." Because he was full of grace and truth, from him we all receive one gift after another. The law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the only Son, is very close to the Father, and he has shown us what God is like.
So when we talked about the incarnation of Christ, we talked about Jesus coming, the Word becoming flesh, right?
Yes.
We discussed that. We also discussed dwelling in the tabernacle and what the tabernacle meant. We talked about him being born of a virgin and why he had to be born of a virgin, why he could not have a man as his Father, and why the Holy Spirit had to be plant the seed. We discussed, and so why did Jesus have to come through a virgin?
It was prophesied that a virgin will bear.
One. That's one good point. What else? Why else did Jesus come, be born?
Fulfill the word of God.
To fulfill the word of God.
Testimony.
There's another reason I'm looking for.
Because if he would have came through the seed of sinful man, then he would have developed a sinful nature. Therefore, he wouldn't have been able to fulfill what he needed to do as deity. So God cannot become, he cannot have a sinful nature and still be God.
He cannot have a sinful nature and still be God. He could not come through sin and still have his deity as God. So he could not be born in sin. How could he save us from sin if he was born in sin? So that's the other reason why he was born into a virgin. And we talked about the rejection of Christ, verse 9 through 11. We also discussed the acceptance of Christ, that was 12 to 13. And then we went through the incarnation of Christ. So we're going to start tonight on our handout, page 8. The representation of Christ to John's disciples.
Presentation?
Yes.
Okay.
So the presentation of Christ through John's disciples. And we'll start at verse 35. Can I get a reader for 35?
35 through 37?
Yes. 35
through 37. The next day. The next day, John was there again with two of his followers. When he saw Jesus walking by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." The two followers heard John say this, so they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following him, he asked, "What are you looking for?" They said, "Rabbi, where are you staying?" Rabbi means teacher. He answered, "Come and see." So the two men went with Jesus and saw where he was staying and stayed there with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two men who followed Jesus after they heard him speak about him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. The first thing Andrew... Huh? Oh, that's what you wanted me to read you?
No.
41?
No. 37.
37.
37?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I went on through.
That's okay. We'll go back to 35. Thank you. We'll go back to 35. And in verse 35, it is talking about 3 days after Jesus' baptism. That's where we are. That's the answer also. The next day, 3 days after Jesus' baptism, number one in your handout.
What is it?
3 days after Jesus' baptism.
Why do you say 3 days?
If you go through, it will say, if you go back, it will say the first day, the second day, and the third day. And if you'll give me a moment, I'll tell you when that is. So the first day was 1 through, after the baptism, was 1 through 19, verse 1 through, so chapter 1, verse 19 through 28. It discusses the first day after the baptism. The second day after the baptism is discussed in chapter 1, 29 through 34. And so where we are here
is the third day.
Yeah, I see it now. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. So the answer to number one is the third day after the baptism. And in number two, it says, who were the disciples? So Andrew was one. He was the first to call. So first called disciple, Andrew. Peter's brother, in verse 40, probably the youngest man, around 21 years old. And then in B, John, the youngest disciple, 17 to 19 years old, when he started serving the Lord.
Wait a minute. Now the two that followed Jesus, one was Andrew.
Mm-hmm.
Who was the other?
John.
No.
Who?
It says, and this is verse 40, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. Mm-hmm. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon.
Peter, that's right, Andrew and Peter.
Peter.
Peter was not the second one. Right. And the reason why I said that, because I asked that question a long time ago.
So who was it?
There isn't an answer, and that's the reason why I wanted to bring it up. No, it isn't, because I've read four different commentaries. Somebody said that it was Andrew, and they gave a name for one other disciple that wasn't a disciple. But what it ended up being is that they don't know the name of the second person. There isn't a name for the second person that was with Andrew. The next time we hear about another disciple is when Andrew went and got his brother Peter.
That makes three.
Okay.
And
so
that was
the second person
case.
Is not named.
Yeah,
is that
it's
what
not
you
named. That
so
is.
That's a good thing to research.
Exactly.
I don't know.
And a lot of the commentaries and all of the scholars don't know. They have some thoughts, but
they have thoughts.
There is not a definitive answer.
So you're saying Andrew was the first.
Right. We don't know who the second was.
Another disciple. By name.
By name.
And then
the other person that was with him was not named.
And then Peter.
Then he went and got his brother Peter.
Okay. So for the purposes of our handout.
He wasn't named.
Andrew was called first.
Right.
In A. B. John, the youngest disciple. Number three, followed Jesus were disciples of John the Baptist. Now we're becoming disciples of Jesus. So the blank, fill in the blank, was disciples of John the Baptist. And then the second blank, becoming disciples of Jesus.
Which one are you reading? Three?
Yes.
So, follow Jesus were blank, who's that? Disciples of John the Baptist. Now they were disciples of Jesus?
Becoming disciples.
Becoming
disciples.
Okay, I got you.
Verse 38. The question is asked, why? Were these the first recorded words of Jesus in his ministry by John? And so he said, Rabbi, which means teacher. So why were those the first words recorded?
They were the first words said to Jesus.
Well, we know how John is, and he's very detailed in his recording, so it may be what he recalled as the first thing Jesus said after the baptism. What do you think?
I'm not following.
So it says, turning around, Jesus saw them following him and asked, what do you want? And then it says, they said, Rabbi, which means teacher. So they were following him. He asked them. They called him Rabbi. And they asked him, where are you staying? So it says, why does these first recorded words of Jesus in his ministry recorded by John?
Come and see.
Was that the answer? Is that what he said?
Yes, he did say, come and see.
So he said, you will see. Yes, he did. So that's in verse 39. That's right. So let's answer our number two is Hebrew, the first blank, and teacher, and then Greek. Number two.
What?
No. What was the question? So why? Why do you call them?
we asked why did Jesus, why was this verse recorded? And Mother said that he replied, come and see. But doesn't really answer why that was first recorded. And I just said it may have been what John recalled the first thing Jesus said after the baptism. After this third day. Not sure, man.
Hebrew.
Second blank, Greek. And number three, abiding or staying. The word dwell means to abide. Abiding or staying. The tenth hour from the sun up was what time? Mother, you read it.
4 o'clock.
4 p.m., 4 in the afternoon. Amen. Verse 40. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, and one of the two heard that John had said, and who had followed Jesus. So verse 40.
Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. Okay. First thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, we have found the Messiah, that is Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, you are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas, which means, and translated, his people. Cephas is translated means Peter.
Cephas translates to Peter.
Now, when we were talking about the two that follow Christ, and if not, it is just from theologians teaching that the scripture is not in the Word of God. They can't fit up with and then Peter came. But that's here and now. It's not in Scripture.
It's not, because my commentary down here says one was Andrew, the other is not named. But from early times it has been thought that he was the author of this gospel, which would make it John, his disciples, and I'm talking about John the author, not John the Baptist, in the sense that they had been baptized by John the Baptist and looked to him as their religious teacher. And when Chaplain Benton was preaching it, I did not know that John, the author of the book, was a disciple of John the Baptist.
Yes.
And I had never been taught that or read that anywhere. So there you go. But it's the second guy that was with Andrew was not named.
So let's discuss the first six. I'm going to the next page of our handout. The first six disciples. And let me know if you agree or disagree. We have listed Andrew, first call, John the youngest, Peter.
Wait a minute, you're saying John the youngest. Who is John the youngest?
That's
the author of the book?
Yeah.
Okay, you're saying he's the second one called?
No.
Not all right. He's
I'm
one of the first six.
Just listing the first six.
Okay.
You found
me? I'm with you. Go ahead.
Andrew, the first called, John the youngest, Peter, James, Philip, and Nathaniel.
All right, I can agree with that.
There goes again, Andrew, John, Peter.
James, Philip, Nathaniel. And so we got an amen, Brother Levine. number three. The first five disciples came from the same hometown, and they knew each other. But they who came from Cana, less than 20 miles away from Jesus' hometown, Nazareth. And Jesus from Nazareth, the son of Joseph, in your blank, put the legal description.
That was where are you on? Look at
page 10, number 5.
Oh, 10.
You have to tell us what you're writing.
I'll go back and get it.
Okay. I got you.
All right.
So number 5. Son of Joseph is the legal description.
Is the what?
It's the legal description.
The legal description of Jesus.
Son of Joseph, son of God.
She's saying legal, so I'm thinking she's meaning what people know him as.
Yes. Like you have a legal name. Yes, ma'am?
Jesus of Nazareth, son of Joseph. Mm-hmm. Legal. You can put in that for illegal?
Yes, that's his legal name. Or you can put legal description.
You're moving pretty far.
So can I get a reader for 20, verse 40 through 42, please?
I just did.
I'm reading from King James, verse 40. It reads, one of the two which heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first findeth his own brother Simon, and said unto him, we have found the Messiah, which is being interpreted the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus, and when Jesus beheld him, he said, art thou Simon, the son of Jonas? Thou shalt be called Cephas, which is by interpretation a stone.
So if you'll turn with me to page 9, under number 10.
Page 9.
Under number 10.
Page 10 or page 9? I don't know.
There's no 10 on there. Page 9.
So it's a Roman number 10. It's an X.
Oh.
Oh, I did, yeah. Thank you.
Yes.
Stay the letter. Verses 40 and 42 is where you
Verses 40 and 42 is where I am. And number one, primary disciple. Primary disciple. He was the primary disciple. Number two, Simon. His name means listener or hearer. So in the blank, listener or hearer.
Simon means what?
Listener or hearer.
And the first one, Peter, means what?
It just says that he's the primary disciple. He became the leader of the disciples.
Okay.
Primary. Jesus renamed him. He renames him Cephas, a rock. We just read that. Number four, search.
Hieristo.
Is
what
that,
does that mean?
It means had found Peter.
And?
H-A-D.
Had found Peter.
Number five. Not first meaning primary, but first in order and before others. Andrew first found Peter, before John found James. James, the silent disciple.
Good evening, good evening. Praise the Lord. Welcome to the Grace Gospel Service. I'm Sunday, Wednesday night, Bible study. And it's good to be in the house of the Holy Lord.
So James, you have James, the silent disciple. And then in number seven, the fill in the blank, they don't naturally come. Brought to lead, there were some reluctant on Peter's part. Number seven. So the blank is they don't naturally come. So people must be led to Jesus. They don't naturally come. So let's go to Philip and Nathaniel follows Christ. And if I can get a reader. Yes, ma'am. Closer to describing his personality, the type of person he was, because he never talked.
And when it's saying he never talked, it he means in Scripture. You don't see James speaking in the Scriptures that often. It's not to say that he was silent and that he didn't talk at all, but that the Scriptures are silent as, in reference to the things that he said, as opposed to like Peter, we quite often hear the things that he said in response to conversations that he was having with Christ and with other people. So there's not a lot written about what the things that James said in the Scripture.
If you notice in the Bible, you don't hear really anything from James until the book that he wrote.
Right.
In the New Testament. James is never part of the conversation. It's too free of them, really never part of the conversation.
Can I get a reader for 43 through 51?
The day following, Jesus would go forth into Galilee and findeth Philip, and saith unto him, Follow me. Now Philip was of Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip findeth Nathanael, and saith unto him, We have found him of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathanael said unto him, Can there anything good come out of Nazareth? Philip said unto him, Come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him and saith of him, Behold an Israelite in whom there is no guile. Nathanael said unto him, Whence knowest thou me? Jesus answered and said unto him, Before that Philip called thee, when thou wast under the fig tree, I saw thee. Nathanael answered and said unto him, Rabbi, thou art the Son of God, thou art the King of Israel. Jesus answered and said unto him, Because I said unto thee, I saw thee under a fig tree, believest thou? Thou shalt see greater things than these. He saith unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man.
Amen. Praise God, praise God. So the next day, we're still talking after the baptism, Jesus left Galilee, finding Philip. And so on the fourth day, John gives an event of each day. He's kind of analyzing each day and describing each day after the baptism. So number one is this, John gives events of each day. Philip is the analytical disciple. He was the leader of the second group of disciples. sincere disciple.
Portland number two, Philip.
Analytical disciple.
Analytical.
So we went over. We went over the first six disciples. We discussed the first five, came from the same hometown. Then we discussed Nathaniel coming from Cana, about 20 miles away. And then Jesus of Nazareth being the legal description of Jesus' name, the son of, Joseph. And then in verse 46, Nazareth, can anything good come from there? Nathaniel asked, come see, said Philip. So this is what Nathaniel was asking. And Philip says, come see. And so on page 10, under verse 46, number one, why does he ask if any good thing comes from here?
They thought that within the law, they had heard that Nathaniel was, you see, he addressed him as
a true Israelite.
He had no guile in him. And it's believed that when he spoke, the Hebrew women, when they work in the field, they tie their babies up in the fig tree so the insects don't come up on them, you know, as they work. And then when he said that, Nathaniel knew right away that he wasn't just faking being the Son of God. He knew right away that he was the Christ.
So, also, Nazareth was known as what type of town?
There we go. Tell them about the city of Nazareth. What was so bad about the city?
What was so bad about the city of Nazareth, Brother V?
It was poor, and it's still poor.
Poor and what else?
It was the projects.
It was poor.
In that part of it, when we went up to Nazareth, we was all so excited. It is still
it was the slums.
Poor. And the Arabs, they build their houses and they add another story. When one get married, they just keep going up like a hotel, but they all family in that house. The Jews on that Arabs over here and the Jews sit over here and their homes are very small.
So
their
neighborhoods were barren.
Slums.
It was slums. But what about morality? What about their reputation?
Well, they were the ones that were cast out, cast down, the people.
They were good. They were believing people. They traveled 90-some miles to go to the temple at the time of Passover to see. So they were devout. They were just poor people.
But they also had an immoral reputation. Cheryl, what was their lifestyle? Like this poor people, like the slums. So that's the answer to A, under number one, is immoral reputation. So it's also known in B, Bravo, it was also known as a town of garbage.
Right.
You said slum. And the Jews did not expect a prophet to come from this area, from this town, this township, from North Israel. That's not where they thought the prophet would come.
Just like that.
But of course they thought he was going to come from royalty, from the upper class. But he came lowly and meek. We already said that Philip was analytical. Verse 47. When Jesus saw Nathanael.
What was three before you go in for it?
Israel.
Israel, okay.
Forty-seven, when Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said to him, "Here is a true Israelite, in whom there is nothing false." Sure, he agreed that he was a true Israelite. Israel was the other name for Jacob, who was a deceiver. And so the fill in the blank here is God changed his name. Number two, the fill in the blank for false fish bait. Can someone explain that?
Fish bait.
Fish bait.
Fish bait.
Who's that?
Jesus was using a Jewish idiom that they, the people in that context, would have understood, that when you throw out, when he says there in whom there is no guile, when you throw out a hook and, you know, with fish bait on it, it's meant not to really feed the fish, but it's meant to catch the fish and so that you could kill him. So he was speaking to Nathanael's reputation by saying, hey, here's not a guy who pretends to be something. He is what he is, whether it's good or bad, but he's not faking the funk. So he was speaking to Nathanael's character and using a idiom or a metaphor during that time that those people knew. It doesn't translate really well into our language, but the people of that particular time would have understood what he was saying.
So they would have understood, if you use the term fish bait, that it was a false action.
Right.
Because the metaphor is that a fish bait is not to feed the fish, but to catch the fish, and to kill the fish, or to eat the fish.
And he uses the name Israelite instead of Jew to make the play on words, because everyone knew that Israel's name was changed from Jacob. So the whole point of Jesus using that name, instead of calling him a Jew, he called him an Israelite, was to use the play on of words from Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, but he's saying Nathanael, he is who he is. So he's speaking to his character in the same way that the name Israel spoke to Jacob's character and it being changed.
Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Because Jacob was a shyster.
Right.
Shyster. That's a
whole
word right there, man. That's a
whole
word right there.
Oh, yeah. He was a shyster. He was a trickster.
There we go.
Verse 48. How do you know me? Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you. So number one, Nathanael, fig tree, a place of meditation. It's the fill in the blank. A place of meditation. A place to be alone. It had big, the fig tree had big leaves and it was cooler. And B, the symbol of the peace of Israel. So number two, Jesus knew what was said there. How did Jesus know? Number two, Jesus knew what was said, and how did he know?
Verse 49, Nathanael declared, Rabbi,
You are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel.
And so where did he get that from?
Where did that thing you get that from?
Where did he get that from?
Actually, it was written in the law of Moses.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's the reason why he said it.
So he said it because it was written in the law of Moses, and he knew the law.
And that's what they were expecting.
They knew the law.
They knew the law. They were followers of John the Baptist, but they were well versed and knew the law.
So what does Son of God mean? Or what is it?
Where are you?
I'm on 11, top of 11. What does King of Israel
mean? I can't hear you.
What does King of Israel mean? I think this is it. What does King of Israel mean?
You better around here?
I think so. So Son of God is the deity, the title of Jesus' deity. He's the Son of God. And then the King of Israel is number two, the title of his sovereign rule. So let's look at verse 50 and 51. And Jesus said,
thank you. So 50 through 51. Jesus says, you believers become because you believe because I told you, I saw you under the fig tree. You shall see greater things than that. Then he added, I tell you the truth. You shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. And so on our handout, number one, the fill in the blank is express doubt. So it says, first of the double verities. Verily, verily, i.e., or truly, truly, expressed doubt. So he's saying, listen to me, I'm telling you. And I'm speaking the truth. Then the angels descend. Or when did the angels descend? Angels descended from Jesus at the ascension. Angels descended at the second coming, at the second coming, that's B. And then angels descended on believers' death. The picture of Jacob's ladder. The only way to enter heaven, the angels use this entrance to heaven in ministering to people. So we see the stairway to hell, heaven, the ladder is the entrance to heaven. So those are the ways that angels have descended in the Bible, just a few of them.
And what would be?
Charlie is believer's death. At ascension. B is the second coming. C is believer's death. And Jacob's ladder. So that brings us to the end of chapter 1 of John. So Jesus is now beginning, he's been baptized and he is now beginning his ministry. Questions, comments, concerns?
He started his ministry in chapter 3.
So.
That's where you get into the.
So this is the introduction of him.
In his ministry.
So this is Jesus being introduced. Amen.
I have one question.
Yes, sir.
In reference to the Nazarene, did they practice, I heard someone say that they travel a great distance to go and worship, but did they practice those parts of the law? Did they not practice any parts of the law?
So it said that their behavior was immoral, so. Probably not. So they were probably, they were probably Sunday goers to church.
Well,
they probably traveled at certain times to go.
Elizabeth and Mary's parents were relatives, so they knew the law, that family especially. So I can't say that all of the people in Nazareth.
No, I wouldn't say all.
Okay.
I wouldn't say
all.
It's like, yeah, just like it is today. You go to church and you go sin and
just
you go
like
do this and you go to that until you come down. When she went to visit Elizabeth, that's when she got the real message, because Elizabeth said, he shouted in my womb, you know. She had gone up to the temple a lot of times with her family, but this was her first experience. So after the angel talked to her, the